we're delighted to have three really outstanding speakers, two of whom are already here.
Say hello to everyone tonight. So I'm Robin, I'm with PDASF, and I want to thank you all very much for being here tonight. And we put on monthly speaker forums on a variety of progressive political topics, and we decided to have one tonight on the environment because of the April science and climate marches. And I'm just curious how many people in the room here went on any of the science and climate marches here at all. Sam, it's a good show of hands, thank you. So that was our thought, to follow up on that, and to basically have very experienced environmental activists here address any remarks that you want to about the climate marches, and then also to address the issues, because the climate and science marches were in a response to what's happening with Trump and the Republicans. And so we would like to hear tonight about what Trump administration is, how they are impacting our environment, and what people are doing to fight back. And there is a lot of pushback going on, which is really wonderful. So hopefully we're going to hear about some of that tonight. So as Shirley mentioned, each speaker is going to have 15 minutes to speak, and then we'll follow with Q&A after that. So I think that's it for announcement. And so our first speaker tonight is going to be Neo Sakashta with the Center for Biological Diversity. And she is in charge of the Oceans program there. She's been with them for 10 years. And she told me that she became an attorney in response to the wonderful legal actions that this center, the Center for Biological Diversity, is accomplishing. So that, isn't that great that an organization actually inspires people to actually go to law school and then go to work for them? And also I wanted to say that I went to the center in Oakland when they sent the caravans across country in the north and the south right after Trump won. And these caravans educated the public and put on concerts. And so then they, the north and the south caravan met up in Washington and put on a joint concert together. And so when I called the center to ask for a speaker, and I said, this is about species, right? The person said, not just species, the habitat of a species is important. So that's a very broad topic, don't you think? The habitat for species. So with that, I'll give you Neo, and thank you very much.
Let's give her a warm Robin. So I wanted to start out by just sharing with you something that is, it's a little bit of a family secret. And to do that, I'd like to take you back to 2006. And that was the year that I got married. And when I did that, I decided that what I wanted to do was kind of do a little family history of love and marriage in my family. So I went home to Utah, which is where I'm from. And I was interviewing my grandma, I call her Bachan, and when I interviewed my Bachan, I asked her, you know, could you tell me a highlight from your marriage? And she thought about it, and she said, you know, marriage was difficult. I basically took care of my mother-in-law for 26 years. This was not the romantic ideal that I had in my mind, it was family history. But the other thing that she did was she shared with me what is somewhat of a family secret, which was that that mother-in-law, who's my great-grandma and my great-grandfather, had been relocated from Sacramento, where they owned a restaurant, to Utah to live in a Japanese internment camp. And, you know, it may not be a surprise, because that's a history of Japanese Americans in the United States, but for me, it was a complete surprise, because 30-some-odd years, and no one had ever told me. And, you know, I had asked, and I had always gotten somewhat evasive answers about it. And so it was at this moment that I was like, this is a family secret. But it shouldn't be, and it's a secret because it's embarrassing. But it really shouldn't be embarrassing for my family. This is a really embarrassing thing for the United States. And it was because the United States is on the wrong side of history there. And we're seeing that again now, with Trump as the president and a lot of the policies that are going through, we're seeing our country being on the wrong side of history again. And so that's why last week, when the federal attorney is in court and defending the Muslim ban, the Ninth Circuit judge asks him, you know, how can this same rationale be used to justify why the Japanese internment happened during World War II? lawyer had to scramble around to come up with a reason why it was different, because we all know now that that was not an acceptable action, that is on the wrong side of history. And so we're seeing that again here, and that's why when I heard about protests at the airport for the Muslim ban, I got on BART and I ran down to the airport and I chanted and I sang with all of the people that were there. And while I was sitting there chanting, I was thinking, man, why did I go into environmental law? I wish I had gone into immigration law, because that's clearly what I need right now. But then when they let the first detainees out, I realized that there is actually an important balance there. And that, you know, on one hand, the lawyers were there and they were helping free these people who had been detained. But the crowds were there and the protesters were there to really tell the world, you know, that this is the wrong side of history and we will not allow this in our society. And so across the country, we had media attention, news attention, and we let the world know this. And so that's, you know, I think a secret formula for how we're gonna win some of these battles and do our resistance is, on one hand, we have the law, and on the other hand, we have our people power. And that is, I'm gonna touch on three things. So one of the things I'm gonna talk about are what are some of the threats to the environment that this administration is putting forward. Secondly, I'm gonna talk about how we can win. And then third, I want to talk about some of the actions we can be taking to fight back that are really pertinent right now. And so on the first point of, you know, what has the Trump administration been doing to the environment, man, it's been like drinking from a fire hose, really. It's I think it's best summed up by this bookstore sign that I saw that pointed people to the current events section if they wanted post-apocalyptic fiction. So some of the key things that Trump has done, you know, one of them has been in the category of climate rollbacks. And so he has ordered a review of the Clean Power Plan. And that is what we're using, well, what Obama put in place to essentially regulate greenhouse gas emissions from our power plants under the Clean Air Act. He's also ordered the review of fuel economy standards. And those are also aimed at reducing pollution that goes into our air. In addition, he has repealed a rule that would require oil and gas industry to report its methane emissions. Mm-hmm. So methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas. So those are some of the attacks on climate. He's also launched attacks on public lands. And so there are a couple of things I think are notable. One, he's lifted the moratorium on coal leasing on our public lands that Obama had in place. And then a second thing, which happened a little recently, and it's got a lot of people angry, is he's ordered the review of 1 billion acres of public lands that are held as national monuments. He doesn't have the power to do that, but nonetheless is attempting to. And then we also saw this week that Trump released his proposed budget, which is a budget that I believe needs to get passed in September, some sort of budget. And in that budget, it recommends a cut of 31% to the Environmental Protection Agency. And so what types of things are those cutting? That's cutting things like hazardous waste cleanup. It's cutting things like public water monitoring to help us prevent the sort of next Flint water crisis. And one of the biggest chunks is actually out of environmental enforcement. So that's basically letting polluters go free. But fortunately, we have the laws, and so citizens, you know, like us, can also enforce some of those environmental laws, and that's exactly what we've been doing. So at the Center for Biological Diversity, we filed 18 lawsuits against the Trump administration for things like not regulating pesticides, for things like we filed a lawsuit against the border wall enforcement program for not having looked at the environmental impacts of the wall, because it not only, you know, it both separates communities and families, but it also separates important habitat and feral species. And we've also filed a lawsuit challenging the constitutionality of the Congressional Review Act, which is a law that Congress is using that sort of fast-tracks their ability to repeal rules put in place by Obama. And so those are an example of a few of the things we've done. And I think that they point to, you know, my next topic, which is how we can win. So I think one of the ways we can really win is using our extremely powerful environmental laws. And we have used these in the past under adverse, you know, Republican administrations. And so, for example, when I was just straight out of law school, I watched my colleagues, and they prevailed in a case challenging fuel economy standards under the Bush administration for not looking at greenhouse gas emissions. And when they won that case, it required all, it set a precedent that federal agencies in doing rulemakings have to look at greenhouse gas emissions and those impacts now. Another example, that same year under the Bush administration, the landmark case, Massachusetts, the EPA came down, and that was the case that sort of set us on the path of being able to regulate greenhouse gases under the Clean Air Act. One of my favorite stories, though, is actually the polar bear. And our organization had petitioned to list the polar bear under the Endangered Species Act because of threats from climate change. And it was a long legal battle, but we finally won. And it was a watershed moment because it actually made the Bush administration have to take climate science and look at it carefully and basically admit that climate change is real and that it's imperiling polar bears. So that's the sort of legal side. And you know, I said we also need the people power side. And so on that side, I'm going to talk now about three of the key actions that I think is really important for us to act on now on environmental things, and kind of lay the groundwork for what you guys can get out and do next. So the first thing that I want to talk about is we have to keep those environmental laws strong, because right now there's a lot of attacks on our environmental laws, and we need them to fight back. So, the first action we want to do is really uphold those laws. And there's a couple things that are sort of eking their way through Congress right now. One of them tries to impose a cost-benefit analysis for all regulations that will, for the environment and public health. Another one requires congressional approval for any regulations that would go into place. So those are the types of things we want to fight off now. That's Senate Bill 21. And Senate Bill 951. But I think where we'll see the real mischief on our environmental laws is actually in riders that are hooked on to things like a big budget bill, or a defense bill, or an infrastructure bill. And so there we'll probably forecasting, we'll see things like wolf delisting, we'll see infrastructure projects like the border wall get exempted from environmental review. And we'll see other little things, sure, that will, slowly etch away at our core environmental laws. So it's important to watch out for those. So first of all, and how to take action on this, I'm curious how many people have used ResistBot in here? ResistBot? Oh, good, I get to teach you about a fun tool.
What's the name of it?
It's called ResistBot. And what it is it sends a fax to your representatives through sending a text message on your phone. Do you guys have your phones? Pull your phone out right now. We'll do it. And open your text messaging program. And what this does is you can write any message that you want to your representative, and it will format it into this gorgeous fax that looks very professional, and it faxes it over to them, and then it confirms the receipt. So if you text to this number, 50409,
wait,
I'll say it again.
50409,
and in the body of your text message, type resist. And then you'll get a couple of prompts, but then it'll ask you, what do you want to tell your representative? And so then I want you to, tell your representative to resist any environmental law rollbacks. And you can add anything else you want to that.
I would, but they want money.
They don't want money.
They did for me. They said there's going to be money. I'm going to charge you. Sorry.
It's been free when I've done it. Okay, well, let's move on from that. Let's move on to action number two.
Do you mind repeating those numbers?
Yes, and I actually have a handout with it on here.
Oh.
So it's 50409. Yeah, if you don't mind kind of handing this out, that'd be great.
Let me just type that in.
And so, okay, so moving on to action number two. We need to oppose offshore oil and gas drilling off all of our coasts. So one of the things that Obama did as he was leaving office is he took the Arctic and the Atlantic and put them off limits, well, part of the Atlantic, put them off limits to offshore oil and gas leasing for permanent protections. And this was secretly actually a very important climate move because it keeps 16 billion tons of carbon dioxide under the ocean. And this is under attack from the current administration. So on April 28th, Trump signed an executive order that sought to repeal those protections for the Atlantic and the Arctic, and also sought to open up the leasing program again for all coasts. So there is an effort underway to open up offshore oil and gas leasing off of all of our coasts that we need to resist. So on one hand, that Trump executive order was totally illegal because Obama's protections were permanent, and so we filed a lawsuit against that. But on the other hand, there's also this public process that's going to be starting in June where they start changing the leasing program so that they can open up more areas to offshore oil and gas leasing. And that's where we need the people power to come out and say, not off our coasts, not off any coasts. We don't want your dirty offshore drilling. And so in the handout that got handed out, today is a national call-in day on offshore drilling. And I'd like you to, you know, look at number one there. There's a script. When we're done here, make a call and oppose those efforts to open up the coast to offshore drilling. And then for my third and final action that I'd recommend, I want to take you guys back to Utah with me. And not too far from where my great-grandparents were interned in Utah is an area that's very special. And was part of, you know, forming my environmental values. It's an area that's now called Bear's Ears. It was not called that back then. And we actually used to run our, like, four-wheel drive vehicles all over it. So this is the type of activity we want to stop in Bear's Ears. And this area is at the epicenter of the Republican attack on our public lands. And so it has been put on a fast track to repeal its national monument status. This area was proposed by 30 Native American tribes because of its important cultural sites, and now they're trying to strip away those protections and hand it over to the state. So the comments for that repeal, which is also totally illegitimate, are due on Friday, so they're due tomorrow. So there's a link on here on the handout that I have on how you can send in your comment and stand with me to save Bear's Ears and not let them take it away. And so, like, together we're going to form that Red Rover line, and we're not going to let through their attacks on public lands.
Okay, so our next speaker is Adam Stow from Food and Water Watch. He's the California director of the organization. And I first met Adam here, I think. It was at one of the environmental film nights that Larry and Melvin run here on Friday nights. Larry is one of our film people here, so thank you, Larry, for your wonderful series. So I first saw Adam Scow answering people's questions, and I thought, there's a guy who knows his material. Because you were not only general, you were specific with every question people were asking about, I think it was a tracking movie. So I called Adam and asked if he would be interested, and he said yes. So we're very grateful to have him and his expertise here tonight, so thank you, Adam.
Thank you. I always like coming to PDA groups, progressives. I was at the PDA luncheon. I saw some of you in Sacramento last weekend. And it was a very exciting time to see a lot of progressives mobilized at the convention. Our C4 Food and Water Action Fund endorsed Kimberly Ellis. Disappointed with the result, but very excited to see the mobilization and energy behind a progressive agenda and a progressive vision for California. And this is very exciting. The best thing about, there's nothing good I can say about Trump, it's all terrible. And there's some great specifics there, and yeah, we gotta fight every rollback. The only thing that I hope we can do in this time is clarify our vision of what we are trying to win as progressives. I'm gonna give you some ideas of what we think that could be for the environmental progressive agenda that we are trying to win through these next elections, and what you can do here locally. I know Ann's going to talk about that too. So obviously we're in a huge climate crisis, and things are looking pretty bad if we continue on course, on the course we've been on for a long time. And I always like to say that the scientists now are telling, not just the advocates, but all the scientists are saying, we're on a hell-bent path to hell. unless we get off of fossil fuels. They were saying that around the Paris Agreement. My understanding is the Paris Agreement didn't even talk about fossil fuels. It's all voluntary. But we have to get off of fossil fuels. That no ifs, ands, or buts. And we're not really doing that yet here in California. For all the talk from Brown, and Brown is, I can tell you, Brown is so happy Trump got elected. I don't know if you can tell. There's all these press clips. Oh, he's leading the resistance, leading the fight against Trump. I'm the hero. He's now going to step up and be the global leader. And sometimes I get pretty disgusted by it because Brown has refused to ban fracking in the state of California.
Right. Yeah.
Brown has accepted millions of dollars in contributions from the oil and gas industry. In fact, he funneled some millions of dollars to the California Democratic Party. Our friends at Consumer Watchdog found this out. A few days ago, the FPPC is encouraging, they're making the California Democratic Party pay $3,000. They didn't mean they were doing anything wrong. Nancy McFadden, who used to work at PG&E, Mark Brown's staffers, chief staffers, has to pay a $300 fine. And I just saw Jamie Court, he's the president of Consumer Watchdog. He's like, this isn't even whitewashing. He's like, it's a bleach bomb. It's so weak. So the point is that in California, wow, you guys are getting blown up here on that tech debt. You guys are getting active. You guys are taking action as we speak. We can't even wait. So we, California, where the, you hear us, we're the sixth largest economy in the world, right? We're bigger than France. We're also the second largest emitter of greenhouse gases in the United States. You know number one is, who's number one?
Texas.
Texas, yeah, of course.
Texas is first.
And greenhouse gas emissions haven't really gone down since the recession of 2008, 2009. Since then, they've been pretty flat. And in some sectors, we've had pollution going up. Oil and gas drilling, surprise. Refineries, which in some cases are being slated for expansion. And we know there's interest in processing tar sands and other heavy crude, not only from California, from North Dakota. And we're not really, we have to stop this. We have to stop this, and we're not doing it yet. And so there's much we can do in California to do that. There's one program I'm gonna talk about that we think is a concern, is more of a threat to deal with this than a solution, and that is the state's cap and trade program. Cap and trade program is actually originally a Republican-supported alternative to pollution reduction around sulfur dioxide emissions in coal plants in the East Coast. That was like the old school Republican compromise where you can slowly reduce pollution if it's well run. This is a well run cap and trade program. You make polluters pay, give them some incentives, corporations like that, and this was the Environmental Defense Fund supported compromise with the Republicans back then. And it's interesting, sometimes it's held up as the big success of cap and trade, but if you looked at what was going on in Europe and Japan, they use direct emissions reductions, and their rate of emissions reductions was twice as fast as what was going on in the East Coast. And when we look at this climate crisis, and if we take it seriously, we need to move fast. And there's a lot of talk about 2050. In our opinion, 2050 ain't good enough, ain't gonna get us there. We need to start transitioning now to get to 100% clean energy by 2030, 2035 at the latest. We need to lead this locally. I know, we talk about community choice, and we need to do this at a statewide level. And everybody can drive a Tesla in this state, I don't care, but the refineries are now exporting oil and gas. These are on global markets. We have to actually stop the drilling. We have to stop the fracking here in California, and it's a very important litmus test for candidates in every office, at every level, going forward, and that's something I think we really need to reinforce with Assemblymember Ting, Assemblymember Chu, and especially as we're having an open gubernatorial race and maybe an open Senate race, we'll see, hopefully, in my opinion, next year. I brought a little fact sheet about cap and trade here. In California, we have not seen emissions reductions. Essentially, polluters can pay. Instead of reduce their pollution, LA had a similar program. After 20 years of failure, they finally scrapped it. And the state should do the same and implement a much simpler, straightforward solution, forcing all of the big polluters to reduce their pollution at the source. It's not that complicated. It's not politically popular. The oil and gas lobby is very powerful in California, They've spent over $100 million in the last decade, and guess what? They're supporting Cap and Trade's extension pretty much with everybody else in Sacramento. It's pretty disgusting. I think we need to put a lot of pressure on Ting and Chu to not support the extension of this program if we're serious about getting off of greenhouse gas emissions in California. And that's something I wanted to say. I got some more information, maybe some questions about that later. A couple other things I wanted to talk about. Well, and just the context of California. The air pollution in California and the Central Valley, and I just came from LA, so I'm a little late. We have a deadly contest every year between the Central Valley and the LA Basin. You see, who's got the worst air quality? Sometimes Houston gets in the mix too, but it's usually Fresno, Bakersfield, LA. Who's gonna be number one? I'm originally from Fresno, so that's why I got out of there. I wanted my lungs to be a little cleaner. And we have several studies that estimate thousands of people die every year because of dirty air, and thousands of people more get chronically sick. So this is a two-pronged necessity for public health and to really set the proper example for how we're gonna get off of how we're gonna reduce greenhouse gas emissions. These cap and trade markets, there's actually a Wall Street interest in this, especially when you add in offsets, emissions trading, we're gonna link markets, China's gonna get on the mix, and it's just gonna prolong emissions at a very high level. I mean, it's a very dangerous program, and I'm sick and tired of seeing New York Times stories say how great Brown is and how wonderful California is. So we gotta turn this around, and I'm encouraging, inviting PDA to get on with this fight.